The government had hoped the Prime Minister's presence in the Lok Sabha yesterday would have unnerved the opposition. There was, however, a surprise that the opposition sprung of sorts on the BJP, which led to the Finance Minister earlier in the day objecting to the chair, PJ Kurian, allowing former Prime Minister Manmohan Singh to start the debate on demonetisation. However, the former Prime Minister did speak and he spoke scathingly on the government policy. The former Prime Minister went on to describe the scheme as organised loot and legalizing plunder. He went on to say that the role of the RBI was perhaps questionable, that this exercise was monumentally mismanaged and would hurt the Indian economy and would damage the agricultural sector in a big way. He warned that GDP estimates could fall up to 2% on the conservative side. The speech invigorated the opposition, which then, turn by turn, targeted the policy and the Prime Minister. But as soon as the Prime Minister left post-lunch, the opposition stalled Parliament yet again, demanding the Prime Minister be present for the entire duration of the debate. Now, that's where the government came back with its hard counter-attack. Leading the fight back was Finance Minister Arun Jaitley. Using the scandals unearthed during the UPA era, Jaitley did not mince any words. A visibly curt Finance Minister decided to read the opposition the riot act, slamming the former Prime Minister's remarks, saying he asked the opposition members to remember the massive scams that happened under the UPA regime before they tried lecturing the NDA government on black money. And in a significant change in the approach the government has used till now to counter the economic criticism of the move, Mr. Jaitley trained his guns firmly on the economist Prime Minister, who was also a former RBI governor, asking whether the Congress believed that the 2G scam, the CWG scam, the 3G scam, the coal scam were not blunders committed by that government. So here we are, deadlocked in Parliament again. As Monday comes calling, the opposition is getting ready for a countrywide protest. Akrosh Day, very interesting week ahead. We discuss the political fallout tonight on The Nation at 9. First, the developments of the day in a snap.
After 6 days of low-intensity firing, the Congress unleashed its economist. What he lacked in oratory, Dr. Manmohan Singh more than made up for in content, taking apart the government's defense of demonetization.
All these players convinced me that the way the scheme has been implemented, it's a monumental management failure, and in fact, it is a case of organized loot and legalized plunder.
Slamming the argument that note ban will help the country in the long run, the former Prime Minister said, "In the long run, we are all dead." Bringing alive another round of opposition attacks.
I have served a notice, moved a notice today. One notice for moving a motion, the motion of contempt against the Prime Minister, what he is showing to this house.
We are opposing you because people are suffering. We are opposing you because we believe the economy will be killed. But why are you making this an issue? Why are you making this an issue? You are some messiah and all of us are devils.
The BJP's own MP Shatrughan Sinha rubbished the results of the Prime Minister's survey that said that more than 90% Indians support demonetization. A cornered government sent the finance minister to the front line.
I think it would be prudent for any economist to really look beyond the immediate impact when the remonetization process is on and look at India post-remonetization.
As the standoff continues, chaos led to another day of adjournments.
House is adjourned.
Will the debate over the debate on demonetization flush out the taxpayers' money throughout the winter session? Bureau Report, NewsX.
Tonight on The Nation at 9, in the studio here, Bhartinder Singh, MP of the Lok Sabha from the BJP. Thank you for joining us. Also with us, Saugata Roy, MP of the Lok Sabha in the TMC. Professor Rajiv Gowda, also a member of Parliament in the Rajya Sabha from the Congress Party. We'll also be joined by another economist, Professor Santosh Mehrotra. He teaches in JNU. Thank you, first of all, for joining us. Professor Rajiv Gowda, let me start with you. Arun Jaitley did not mince his words today. He said very clearly that, yes, the Prime Minister came, sat for the debate, we heard you out. Then you're only looking for reasons, excuses to stall debate. And that is why you want him to be present all the time. Now, we heard the former Prime Minister's economic argument today. Mr. Jaitley says, do not lecture us Do you think CWG was a blunder or all the other scams that happened under the UPA were a blunder? He has a point.
Ready?
Yes.
Essentially, when we asked... Kuch to ho raha hai.
Yes, go ahead.
When we asked for... Okay, Kishore, go ahead. Okay. Once we asked for the debate, when we saw the Prime Minister come to Parliament, finally, we essentially said that the Prime Minister should stay, and on that condition, we would continue the debate.
No, but that's why condition the debate? The Finance Minister says you
could
one condition
of the
one
of
day,
India that
two more conditions the next
through
day.
The members of Parliament.
You're changing goalposts, Mr. Gowda.
Okay. Not at all. Not at all. Not at all. The Prime Minister has, our Prime Minister, Dr. Manmohan Singh, stayed through debates when Mr. Jaitley, as leader of the opposition, demanded it. Here, when the country is going through a monumental crisis, we want and we have enough and more suggestions for how to turn things around. It's incumbent on the Prime Minister to sit down and pay attention. You know, he is the one who is actually solely responsible for this historic blunder. And we want to...
You're still calling it a blunder? Okay. If you saw Mr. Arun Jaitley's press conference today, if you saw the Prime Minister's reply, he painted a picture, and Bhartendra Singh, I want you to come in here, that the opposition bereft of ideas, a bankruptcy of ideas, monumental corruption under this regime is not answering the NDA that you should go about committing economic blunders. I mean, do you think Professor Rajiv Gowda is saying...
Absolutely. I know Professor Rajiv Gowda is a very learned man and a professor of economics. But it just, you know, after all, what can the opposition say? Can they say we should have black money? Can they say counterfeit currency is good? People should hoard, thousands of crores of corrupt money in their homes. So by demonetization hasn't really been aimed at the common man. Demonetization has only affected the people with thousands and thousands of crores of rupees lying stashed away. It is only going to touch upon them. And we were told, the BJP MPs were told to go into lines and to talk to people and to get the reaction and post all the reactions back on the PM app. And all of us have done
This is a very controversial issue, Bhartendra Singh. The opposition says this app really is just a drop of water in a sea of complaints here, because they say penetration, smartphone penetration, is not more than 15% all across the country. And that too, they allege a private army responded to this.
Well, all we are in majority. All the BJP MPs were told to go and get in touch with the people in lines. I have been personally from bank to bank talking to people, and the people, by and large, I admit, there is a lot of inconvenience caused because of this step, but there was no other way of taking it. The secrecy had to be maintained, and the people are backing it up. That is what your reports are saying.
Well, you know, that is what your service are saying. The reports are mixed, sir. I mean, there is some easing out in urban centers, of course, but it changes day to day, and as honest as I can be. But you know, I want to shift your focus back to what the former Prime Minister said, and which Mr. Jaitley later tried to debunk. That the very fact that in what country in the world has anyone ever seen that you're asking the population to deposit your own money in the bank, but you can't take it out. And that in itself is why this policy should be condemned. Do you still defy that logic?
Nobody is defying that logic. The government is not defying that logic. The government is completely agreeing that there is inconvenience caused. We want to have a debate. We want to get in the suggestions. We want everybody to give suggestions. Everybody, please give suggestions, only if you allow the debate. As you just correctly pointed out, they shift the goal every day.
Well,
because there
that.
Is nothing to say.
They deny that. Saugata Roy joins us, Professor Bhartendra Singh. Professor Saugata Roy, the TMC has been at the forefront today. You're leading marches. Derek O'Brien spoke in Parliament for the duration of the debate that lasted in Parliament today. We understand that the opposition senses or feels that it can corner the government in Parliament, and that's why the relentless pressure. Indications today were, sir, the government is pushing back as far as this is concerned. The Prime Minister came, did his duty, listened to the debate, but he's not going to let you hold him on Parliament ransom. You can't hold a gun to the government's head and say that, look, we will change goalposts, we will ask for new conditions every day, and you do it the way we ask you to do.
No, no, please listen to me. When, after lunch, the debate resumed, the Prime Minister was not there. Anand Sharma, from what I heard on the TV, Anand Sharma from the Congress pointed out that in a similar debate in 2013 on the 2G scam, Mr. Jaitley, who was then the leader of opposition, had demanded that the Prime Minister be there all the time. And then the Prime Minister came and sat there for 2 days. Heavens would have not fallen if the Prime Minister sat through the whole debate after lunch. There is no question of shifting goalposts. It's all about demanding that the Prime Minister, who possibly without even informing his finance minister,
conjecture.
Took this stupendous step.
I call it conjecture on that.
Disrupting the economy, disrupting a conjecture, like yourself,
please don't interrupt me.
No, I was keeping quiet.
Don't interrupt me. Whatever you have to comment, you comment afterwards. Why are you interrupting me? Please don't do that.
I'm just saying, it's conjecture.
Don't interrupt me in mid-sentence. That's all right. You've said it. Why are you repeating it? You've said it.
Go ahead.
So, the Prime Minister could have sat through this debate. If heavens would not have fallen, there is no foreign dignitary visiting India at the moment, he could have sat. The government, instead of the Prime Minister sitting in the house, Mr. Jaitley chooses to go and address a press conference. He said about Manmohan Singh, who had called this step a monumental mismanagement and organized plunder and legalized loot. He said that Manmohan Singh should speak about the blunders. Manmohan Singh spoke about plunder and Mr. Jaitley spoke about the blunders in Commonwealth Games, coal scam, 2G scam.
I'm sure the
now,
word
all
plunder
those
also
issues
applies
were debated, discussed. People went to jail because of 2G, because of CWG. And Mr. Modi came back to power because of those corruption scandals. So they were blunders. But those blunders do not give the present government the right to ride roughshod over the people.
Now you're making the point I want Mr. Singh to answer. Now you're making the point, Saugata.
It is harvesting season.
You're making the point now that I want Mr. Singh to answer. You've heard Saugata Da here, and he says that does not, any amount of corruption in the past does not give any government the right to ride or perhaps keep your decision there and fire from it.
The thing is that this attitude of the opposition, we saw it in the last session also, you know, you disrupted parliament, so we'll disrupt parliament. An eye for an eye, and let's have the whole country going blind. How can we continue with this?
Why not?
You were criticizing the same thing the last time. You are repeating it this time. Can't we move on? This is a different parliament. This is the 16th parliament. Are we keep going to making the same mistakes that we made earlier? This is a full majority government. This is a people's prime minister who has the courage to take strong decisions. Do you have the courage to challenge this decision? What debate? You don't have anything to say. That is why you're disrupting the house. If you have something to say, please go ahead, say it. The government had started the debate in the Rajya Sabha. We want to hear you. You don't have anything to say.
Yeah, but they say that the kind of implementation of this monumental step
we have a lot to say
has been completely shoddy. And that is what they want to talk to the Prime Minister, I presume, and the government about. But there is absolutely no consensus. There was an informal meeting, which the government data denied was a meeting in the morning there. An outreach that was snubbed by the opposition, Bhartendra Singh, is going to get more difficult to make parliament work from here on end. Quickly.
Well, I think this is just law management. I think this is just posturing in parliament that is going on. The opposition is doing this. It's Thursday evening, Friday tomorrow, Saturday, Sunday goes to leave. So why not have 4 more days of posturing and then we get down to work on Monday? But the country, by and large, according to all the data that is being shown on television, is standing by the Prime Minister and his decision.
You mean the survey says that 90%?
The survey is, all your surveys are saying that, not one survey.
Well, I'm aware of the Prime Minister's survey and there have been serious doubts raised by the opposition on that.
No, not the Prime Minister's survey, but the CSAT survey.
Okay, the Sea Voter survey, yeah. The Sea Voter survey I've heard.
Yeah, the different surveys that are being shown by different television channels.
I'm sure there are people of this panel that want to doubt the authenticity really and the veracity of these numbers and figures. I'll give you, Chah Santosh Mehrotra joins us in the meantime, another economist as well. As S.Y. Absolutely. Qureshi, former IAS officer, thank you for joining us, Mr. Qureshi. Let me start with Mr. Qureshi right now. What has unfolded in the past 2 weeks, Mr. Qureshi, has affected each and every life in the country? Currently, we're at a stage where Parliament is in deadlock right now. And on a mere technicality, the government and the opposition seem to be locking their horns. The fact is the Prime Minister attended the debate today. He stayed, then he left. Is the opposition justified in saying that he stay for the entirety, given the fact that this is perhaps the biggest economic upheaval that any of us have seen in I think, a couple of generations?
Yes, from a face, it's the most important problem in the country at the moment, and it would have been very nice if Prime Minister was there. And I really see no reason why he chose not to come.
Well, he did come, but then
in the process, we wasted 3-4 days. It was good that he finally came. And if he had sat through, it would have been a great idea. But I don't know, he must have his own political reasons.
Yes, go ahead, sir.
Yeah, finished.
Okay. I beg your pardon. I want to come to the implementation.
Very good if you have attended from the day one.
And the government seem to be working on, and some easing out in urban centres possible. We'll go back to the planning and the execution of it in just a bit. Santosh Mehrotra, the economic argument as presented by the former finance and the Prime Minister Manmohan Singh. Former Prime Minister Manmohan Singh made his remarks today, and he made it very simple in terms of him being an economist, a former Prime Minister. He got a political reply later from Mr. Jaitley. But do you think that particular time when he said that this is affecting too many people and there will be the longer term gain, he quoted John Maynard Keynes, I think, and ultimately in the long run we are all dead, sir. Do you think that struck a chord with a lot of people today?
Well, people whose livelihoods have been thrown out of gear are obviously going to sympathize with what Dr. Manmohan Singh said. Let's face it, that 99% of the enterprises in our country are unregistered. Only 1% are registered. About 80% of all workers in our country work in the unorganized sector, meaning in enterprises that employ less than 10 workers. Now, both unregistered enterprises as well as these workers, 80% of them, rely upon cash for their day-to-day transactions. It's a means of exchange for them.
No.
And what we are seeing repeatedly, every media is telling us, that agriculture, manufacturing, trade and transport are all slowly grinding to a halt. So there is no question that there is going to be
while,
a sharp
the situation
decline
gets
in GDP,
better,
quite apart
the
from the
government
pain that
is
the population is going
much
through.
Better, Professor Mehrotra. I've been discussing this for the past 2 weeks, so I know, trust me, every economic argument that has been said on TV, and I know them back and forth. My question is, the government claims this is very temporary. The government also claims there is no shortage of cash. Of either notes being printed or the delivery to the rural areas. There is waiver after waiver coming in. There is improvisation almost every day we see. Today we saw a long list of improvisations. Now you could argue really, this is an incremental piecemeal sort of approach to rolling out a policy.
The government is trying to, can you just listen to me? Atar, don't give me a long lecture. Atar, don't ask a question as though you are giving me a lecture.
I'm merely reiterating the government's point here.
Please understand. No, I know the government's point of view, sir. I also read and watch.
Yes.
So, can you please hear me out?
Of course.
We know that the government is trying its best. But the real question, sir, are twofold. One, after the 31st of December 2017, has the government planned enough actions to sustain pressure on the creation of black money? Because precisely over this next month, the 500, new 500 and the 2000 rupee notes will be available. And how are we certain that we will not be generating black money with these?
That's a question many others have asked.
You have to turn the tap off. There's no point in mopping the floor while the tap is on.
Okay, therefore,
we have to be assured not just that the rupees will be, that the 500 and 2000 will become available, but more importantly, is the government going to sustain pressure on the mining activities where the black money is generated, on private education where black money is generated, in the siphoning off of government schemes into private hands?
What about the real estate? Is the government going to try and crack down by reducing the stamp duty?
These are practical things that the government has to do to sustain action on black money.
Fair enough. You asked the questions. Let's hope for an answer. Go ahead, Bharatendra Singh. You heard.
The problem in India is that 12% is, as compared to developed countries, where there's only 4% of cash, of the GDP, we have 12%. So there is a flood. There's not mopping up, there is flood. So we need to clean this out somehow, which is what is happening right now. As far as the intention and the seriousness of the government, we've already had agreements of overseas money stashed away with Cyprus. We've had agreements with Mauritius. We are about to have an agreement with Singapore. So all that is being done. You know, blue corner, red corner notices have been issued.
They are all prospective.
The agreements are coming through. The government is very serious. They are going to hit at black money. The Prime Minister has already announced repeatedly he's going to hit at Benami property transactions
from 2017.
You know, I also want to ask you, since you mentioned the generation of black money and really the government, Subramaniam Swamy, also a former finance minister, of course, has been saying, and he's been critical, let me tell you, Bharatendra Singh, despite being from the BJP, of the implementation, as has been many people otherwise as well. But he says this particular measure, this war on black money is incomplete.
Subramaniam Swamy was never a finance minister.
I beg your pardon, he was commerce minister. I beg your pardon, you're right, Saurabh, obviously, under Chandrasekhar, I believe. He says that apart from this, if you don't move towards an income tax less society, this move perhaps is not going to yield much. Now, what do you say to that? There are more steps coming. We understand that the Prime Minister has hinted. But we don't know if you're talking that drastic.
No, the steps are coming. And the Prime Minister is not going to hold back his punches as this step has shown. As earlier steps have also shown, he's committed to mopping up the economy, to cleaning up the economy, and to having... To give as much impetus to a digital and on-board economy as possible.
At what costs? I mean, there are reports of people dying because of reasons directly or indirectly related to demonetization. The Congress alleges there have been more than 70 deaths.
Question is not at what cost alone. Real question.
Yes, no, there are many more questions, sir, of course. The longer-term argument is still a pretty speculative one.
Is the rural economy even ready for cashless? You don't even have enough people in the rural areas with bank accounts because Jandhan accounts are not reaching the unbanked households. Many new members of the already existing households that had bank accounts, new members within those same households have got Jandhan accounts. That doesn't mean that unbanked households have suddenly become banked in rural areas in particular.
Okay.
So the government has to look very carefully.
Professor Rajiv Gowda, let me just go back to you for a second.
Households have been captured in them or not?
Of course. Let me go to Professor Rajiv Gowda here. Going back to Parliament and going back to Monday, sir. Monday is going to be Akrosh Divas, if you believe the opposition, and it's going to be a countrywide protest. The fact that the die has been cast, sir, there is no question of a rollback, Professor Gowda. Everyone understands that now. So shouldn't then the opposition be trying to somehow sit across the table with the government and give them your suggestions? Because this has been done now. Rolling back is not even an option. India has to live with it. shouldn't cooperation in parliament so that we ease the people's troubles forever in the short term, the medium term, it could take months to print new currency, be a top priority for the Congress party? The BJP believes, and many other people do, that you're not doing that.
Not at all. We are the first party to say, well, you've already broken the egg. Now we cannot put the contents back in. We are basically saying that if you try to roll back and create confusion, then even the faith in the currency will be affected. So we're not pushing for a rollback. We're basically saying, okay, how can we help you manage the situation better? And for that, we asked for a proper debate. We wanted the Prime Minister to come. Today he came for his question hour. He didn't necessarily come to take part in any debate. And we want him to listen. We will channel the woes of India, the challenges that the people are facing, and we will give you concrete suggestions. The first day in Parliament, many concrete suggestions came from the Congress party and from many others in the opposition. And many things that we're talking about on air, we're writing about, for example, about the challenge about cooperatives, all party delegation from Kerala wanted to meet the Prime Minister saying, please, you're shutting down the cooperatives, the farming sector in Kerala is suffering. Please meet us and listen to us and take action. And he refused to meet. So who is not taking action here? Who is refusing to listen to suggestions? Who is ensuring that the suffering gets worse?
Professor Gowda,
you use the analogy of a gun and things like that. If someone has taken a gun to the economy and pressed the trigger, and that someone is Narendra Modi.
The government counters that by saying on the first day there was an unconditional debate, there were no preconditions, there was no condition at all. The opposition was won and the government wanted a debate. Suddenly, from the second day onwards, if you believe the government, you ran out of ideas to corner the government because according to the government, the people are with them. Then you started stalling.
Oh, please.
Then you started looking for reasons to stall parliament because you lack you have a bankruptcy of ideas. These are the government's words.
Absolutely not. That is absolute bunkum. We are aghast at the deaths of people in the lines, at the chaos unleashed on the economy. And Dr. Manmohan Singh expressed it very succinctly today when he talked about the unorganized sector, when he talked about women, when he talked about others, labor, etc., who are really, really hurt. And so what we wanted was the Prime Minister to come and listen. He should have shown up on the first day itself. Instead, what you had was, sort of an arrogance, the Prime Minister's arrogance towards the institution of Parliament. He will refuse to address it. He will refuse to attend it. He will only address the people directly through TV and unleash havoc on the economy in a single-handed, blind manner.
Let me quote,
in such a way that
let me quote the Finance Minister one more time.
Give him suggestions on how to repair things. Well, I hope he comes on Monday, and I hope he comes once more.
Saugata Roy, this is the Finance Minister speaking to media persons outside Parliament, and he says, and I quote now, "Charcha ke dauran ye mehsoos hua ki vipaksh ki koi tayari nahi thi. Wo bas chahte the ki PM charcha mein shamil ho. There was no mostly noise and no substance in what the opposition has been saying." Direct charge from the Finance Minister. Saugata Roy, reactions.
That is Mr. Jaitley's glib talk. He is the defender of faith, being Narendra Modi's principal factotum. He is not talking like a finance minister of India. The fact is that by the action of the government, millions and crores of people have been put to so much difficulty. Industry after industry is closing down. All the cities which have small-scale industry like shoe industry in Agra, glass industry in Moradabad, in our own state, the jute industry, the tea industry are in great difficulty. People are facing starvation. We are trying to bring this to the notice today in Rajya Sabha. Our member Derek O'Brien pointed out to all the difficulties that people face. So if Mr. Jaitley glibly says that opposition had run out of ideas and that he has better economic ideas than Dr. Manmohan Singh, a world-renowned economist, then he is deceiving himself.
Quick
the government believes in deceiving itself. They say that on a mobile app, Everybody has supported them, but his own party man, Shatrughan Sinha, says it's a bogus survey.
All right.
Shiv Sena Uddhav Thackeray has given again one statement today, saying that this step is against the interests of the people. Basically, Narendra Modi's surgical strike has disrupted our economy, disrupted all sectors of our economy.
The government clearly disagrees with you.
Yes. That our GDP will drop by 2%.
That's a conservative estimate.
Is touching 70 rupees per
dollar. That's exactly what the government is saying.
The Sensex has fallen. The economy is facing a total crisis.
Okay, that's
we are quoting Mr. Jaitley.
No. He's the Prime Minister of the country.
On behalf of the...
I just want to come back to this, the point you've raised, Saugata Roy. And I want closing comments from all my guests. But I'll take a very short break right now.
Let him win an election and come.
We'll be back in 30 seconds. Closing arguments as we go into another deadlock day of Parliament tomorrow. We'll come back in 30 seconds. Closing comments after. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back. We, of course, were discussing what transpired in Parliament today and what could happen tomorrow. How do you see this going forward, Professor Rajiv Gowda? In fact, let me just tell our viewers also, we have the live shots coming in of the Cabinet meeting that is still on, we believe. And those are live shots coming in. It's happening under the chairmanship of the Prime Minister, Narendra Modi, and all the top senior ministers are present and it's still going on. As far as we can tell, those are live visuals coming to you from New Delhi. Let me go back to Rajiv Gowda. Closing arguments, Rajiv Gowda. If you are not willing to settle for anything less than what you're demanding, which is Prime Minister be present at all times during the debate, how is Parliament going to function, sir? How is the concern that you say you want to bring to Parliament and to the Prime Minister, how is that objective going to be achieved if there is absolutely no business happening in Parliament?
I hope the Prime Minister comes. I hope the Prime Minister gives us an opportunity to present to him the suggestions that we have for repairing the damage that he has caused. And I do hope that Parliament can function. We are eager. We have a wealth of ideas and suggestions, unlike Mr. Jaitley's glib comments. And all we need is the Prime Minister to reach out and say, I will be there and I will listen to you, just like he spent 1 hour today. That 1 hour is such a off thing, you know, it's not something that he does. Cannot he not respect the institution of Parliament? Why cannot he respect the views of the opposition?
But who
the
says
people of India that we represent?
You know, it's a charge that you're making that he's superseding Parliament and this and that, whatever you said, Rajiv Gowda. The government has every right to say that, look, we took a step for the larger good of the country. We believe in it. We're not going to go off message. And the fact that we're going to follow through with more steps that are coming to mitigate whatever crisis that seems to have been generated in the country right now, but they're going to harden their stance.
Absolutely, that is the exact opposite, that's the exact counter reaction that nobody wants. We want the government to make amends. They've already goofed up. This is really the wrong way to go about it.
Bhartendra Singh, you have to respond.
This is going about it the wrong way. There are numerous, GST was coming. You would have been able to track every transaction and eliminate black transactions. There was so much that could have been done through election reform. You know, instead, you go through this dramatic gesture, which is going to yield nothing, going to cost the economy its growth, and it's going to already cost 70 people's lives.
Rajiv Gowda, the government has a right to respond. Please go ahead. Nothing is going to turn around so quickly.
Well, let me respond to you, Rajiv. The thing is that the Prime Minister was there yesterday, the Prime Minister was there today, the Prime Minister has been attending Parliament regularly. The Prime Minister has spoken more in the last 2.5 years than the former Prime Minister, Mr. Manmohan Singh, or Manmohan Singh as he had been called, has, I think, spoken in the last 5 years. There is no reason to say that the Prime Minister will not respond. I want to assure you, as a part of the government, that the Prime Minister will respond. He certainly will. He's a great orator. He enjoys Parliament. We've seen him before and we're going to see him again. Believe me, we will. Secondly, about what we were saying, that, you know, why are we forcing into digitization? I just want to tell you that 2.25 crore people travel in the trains every day, out of which 58% people are buying their tickets online. Digitization is happening and it's going to grow. We want it to come into the financial sector, and it is going to happen because the country wants it. The people want it. They want the economy cleaned up, and that is why all the data that we are getting, all the surveys that are coming, that I have heard on television, are saying that it's all good. About what the government is doing, again, I might be repeating, that the printing
the price
to the
that
bank,
you're making the
printing,
country
allow
pay,
me, Rajiv,
the price to pay,
I the didn't interrupt,
pay for these
I didn't
kinds
interrupt,
of
Rajiv,
to
allow me to economy, finish.
It's
please
not,
allow me
it's
to finish.
Not allow, it's not.
Allow me to finish. The printing to the bank used to take 25 days to 21 days. Now it's being done in 5 days. The government is responding. Notices, income tax notices have been sent to people who are depositing money suddenly into their banks. Gold sellers have been cracked down upon to make sure that this doesn't happen. And seed purchases have been allowed. Allowed to be made. So what your argument about the wheat sowing was is also, so the government is completely responsive. The government wants to hear you. The government wants to have the parliament functioning, and we all know that, and the country also knows that.
Now, Professor Rajiv Gala, you have to respond. You can't just shake your head.
I'm pointing out that if you wanted to move to a cashless economy, to digitization, you could have done it in simpler ways. You didn't have to cost the economy 2% or more of its economic growth. You didn't have to disrupt the entire economic structure of the country. And this is the most, you know, misguided misadventure on the part of Narendra Modi, Prime Minister, in order to garner headlines, which he's very good at. He may be a very good orator, but he will talk emotional stuff. He will miss out on the fact that India's economy is taking a huge and unnecessary hit as a result of his actions. Whatever scrambling he's doing now, which Bharatendra Singh, my friend, is pointing out to, is not going to remedy the impact on the poorest of the poor, on
all
the
right.
marginal
Quick
people
Rajanda.
That you don't care
5
about.
Lakh
Quick
crore Rajanda. Rupees has been deposited in bank accounts. Now, when suddenly 5 lakh crore already has been deposited in bank accounts by people, when this money suddenly gets mopped up, is it going to promote the economy or is it going to bring a recession? So let's be honest. The money is coming in. The money, the Prime Minister says 50 days. The Prime Minister has asked you for 50 days of support, and he's going to put everything back on his rails. Why can't we wait for 50 days?
Professor Santosh Mehrotra, 50 days is what the Prime Minister has asked. A more realistic target, really, of getting liquidity back as at the levels we wanted would be perhaps 2 months, maybe even more. How would you respond to Bharatendra Singh's take and the government's take on the situation that you and I and all of us currently face right now?
No, it's highly likely that Bharatendu is right, that we will have enough 500 and 2,000 rupee notes to remonetize. My question is a bigger one, which goes deeper. After the 31st of December, is the government going to crack down on the 5 or 6 main sources of black money? So you might have now cleaned up the stock of black money, but what about the flow of black money, which is continuing and will resume? Private education, real estate, gold and diamond jewelry. In addition, of course, but hold on. This has to be addressed by the government. But you need to now understand who are the beneficiaries of black money. The political class, the entire political class that is on your channel are the beneficiaries. I want you to know that of the 8,500 candidates for the 2014 Lok Sabha election, 54% had not filed an income tax return.
Yes.
54% had not filed an income tax return.
All right, fair point.
So who is benefiting from the black money? Obviously, electoral reform is absolutely critical.
So
you have to attack
the point.
The mining, the gold and diamond jewelry.
Someone made
the
point
mining, the mining sector has been corrected to a large extent, as we saw with the coal auctions. and we are going to continue that work, as we can clearly see by the stance of the government. Gold has already been given a hit, and property, the Prime Minister has already worded it, that he is now going to look at Benami transactions very seriously. So the government is moving completely on what you are pointing out.
Okay, one more thing. Somebody pointed out, I think, the fact that people seem to have the biggest problem with the idea that it's their money, why can't they take it out? I mean, is there any sense that limits perhaps or restriction on withdrawals could ease as we get the cash back in new notes, as we limp towards really the new normal or normalcy as we know it? Do you think it's going to matter?
No, I completely agree with you, and I completely agree with my friend Rajiv Gowda and our learned and senior colleague, Mr. Sugato Roy, that there is a lot of inconvenience caused, and the Prime Minister is completely, and the entire government is very worried about it, but there was no other way. Had we wanted to maintain the secrecy, if you want this to become a success, then it had to be suddenly done this way. There was no way that we could have suddenly increased the number of ATMs, we could have had more 100 rupee notes, 10 times the amount in the economy. These would have been all clear signals, and people would have cleaned out their money anyway and changed it. This system had to be shocked. Shock is giving us a bitter pill, but it will have its results, and they will be good results.
Okay, fair enough. S.Y. Qureshi, I'll give you the last word. That the fact that there have been concerns from the market as well as economic experts who say that institutional heads like the RBI governor should be out there calming people down, giving a good message that we have it under control. Perhaps the finance minister should speak more. The chief economic advisor, sir, has rarely been seen speaking to the media, and he's the chief economist of this government. Do you think all these institutional heads should be coming out there more? And if the government is so confident and so sure of the good recovery it's going to make, perhaps calm people down a little bit.
Yes, of course, communication is extremely important. When the entire nation is agitated, there should be communication from responsible people, from the government. It did not happen.
We are not getting to the voice. So,
but allow me to
since we are not getting to the voice.
We are getting
again and again.
We are getting in the studio.
And I think that
Go ahead, Mr. Qureshi, we can hear you.
Yeah, corruption in the election is the root cause of all corruption in the country.
That link seems to be frozen. So, sorry about that, Bhatan Singh. Go ahead, please.
All I want to say is that the government is supporting its decision. It is giving all the support that is needed. The Prime Minister is personally, and the Finance Minister are personally supporting this. I agree with you again. It is the bureaucracy that needs to now, gear up and take on the work and deliver. The government is completely supporting it in all that the bureaucracy, all the suggestions that they are making. But it is the job of the bureaucracy to deliver, and they must deliver now.
All right. We'll leave it there. Thank you for joining us, Professor Santosh Mehrotra, Professor Rajiv Gowda, Saugata Roy, S.Y. Qureshi, and Bhartendra Singh. Apologies to S.Y. Qureshi. There was some audio link problem there.